Welcome back to Wheel of Proko. Skelly, it's your turn. There's only one letter left.
Give me a K!
Welcome to Proko. I'm Stan Prokopenko. Last time, we introduced the four muscle layers of the abdominal wall. We already learned about the vertical rectus abdominis, and we learned about the horizontal transversus abdominis. Well, the premium students learned about it. Now let's learn about the diagonal external oblique. Beginners often get overwhelmed by the interlocking digits of the serratus and oblique. They draw a bunch of out-of-control stripes across the side of the figure. That ends today. Let's be disciplined boys and girls and start by learning the anatomical basics. Then we can have fun and learn how to draw the forms. Anatomical basics. The name external oblique refers to the muscle's position being on the outside, contrary to the internal oblique, which is on the inside. And it refers to the diagonal angle of the muscle fibers. External means outside, oblique means diagonal. The external oblique is a sheet muscle, which means it's large and thin, and its muscle fibers are parallel. It sits on the sides of our torso and connects the rib cage to the pelvis. When flexed, the digitation of the oblique is revealed, and you see tube-like striations at 45 degree angles on the upper half. This upper half is called the thoracic portion, and the lower half is called the flank portion. It originates off the bottom 8 ribs and inserts onto the anterior 2/3 of the iliac crest, xiphoid, the linea alba, and pubis. The muscle fibers don't reach all the way to the linea alba. They attach to the tendon, called the abdominal aponeurosis, at the edge of the linea semilunaris. This large aponeurosis covers the entire rectus abdominis muscle. Motion. The function of the oblique is to bend the spine laterally and to twist it. When both sides work together, they flex the torso forward, which is incidentally the exact sequence you use when you warm up, attempt to dance, and then pick up your pride off the floor. Sometimes we're our own worst enemies, much like how the external oblique is its own antagonist. When one side flexes, the other side stretches, and vice versa. When the oblique is flexed, you'll see digitation on the thoracic portion. The flank portion stays smooth, except maybe a hint of the digitation along the medial edge. The motion that will flex the obliques most is a twisting and bending combo, basically the angle of the muscle fibers. When twisting without any kind of bending, there's actually little effect on the oblique. The lumbar vertebrae are very limited in their twisting range of motion. You'll just see a subtle twisting of the muscle. When bending forward, the compression is in the abs, as we learned last time. When bending backward, even though it's a very limited motion, the skin quickly folds. When you bend side to side, a prominent fold is created at your waist. If the bend is really extreme, it might be a double fold. Use the concept of squash and stretch. When you're drawing one compressed side, exaggerate how the flesh is bunched up and really stretch the other side. You might even show the bony iliac crest and rib cage on the stretched side to show how tight the skin and muscle are being pulled. Robo bean and Anato bean. Remember the bean and Robo bean from the figure drawing course? Well, a lot of the motion we drew for the pinching, stretching, and twisting was an indication of what's happening to the obliques. The bean was basically two ovals connected with skin, like two balls in a sock. but I'm more interested in reviewing the Robo bean because it has hard corners that indicate two important skeletal landmarks: the 10th rib of the rib cage and the acis of the pelvis. These are so useful for drawing the obliques in motion. Now, what about the bucket and the geometric rib cage that we learned about earlier in this course? Let's call these the anatobean. The concept and purpose are similar to the robobean, but the robobean is simpler. We can say that the robobean is beginner, and these are advanced. This edge of the bottom box on the robobean follows the angle of the oblique. It's the angle you'll see on the surface. The bucket is a little tougher and can be counterintuitive. It follows the angle of the front half of the iliac crest and then keeps going. The bucket is more anatomically accurate if you have a handle on perspective. If you're struggling with the construction of the bucket, the robobean can be a good option for you. If perspective is new, try the robobean. If you're up for the challenge, try the bucket. Assignment. So go ahead and try it. Use the model photos from proko.com/poses and draw the pelvis and ribcage. You can use the beginner or advanced version. Then add the oblique with the correct stretching, pinching, or twisting. Think about the motion and how the motion deforms the shape of the muscle. So we have a premium section for students that want to learn more. The premium section has extended lessons with more information about the topic. It also has additional drawing demonstrations. If you do the assignments for each lesson, these demonstrations serve as the answers for the assignment, so you can check your work. There's an ebook version of each lesson that you can download as a PDF. Print them out or keep them on your device so you can quickly review the lessons. And finally, the premium section has 3D models that you can spin around, study, and draw from any angle. If you don't want your drawings to look like this, go to proko.com/anatomy. If you like this video, don't be all selfish. Share it with your friends. And if you want to be updated about new videos, click this button or go to proko.com/subscribe. That's it. Thanks for watching. If you're posting your drawings on social networks, use the hashtag Proko, or consider posting them in one of the Proko Facebook groups. You can find them on proko.com/groups.